Thank you very much. Not quite sure which ones are working here, so we'll just pretend we know. Je suis très contente d'être ici. Je voudrais remercier tous les gens qui ont travaillé pour établir l'événement ici. I know it took an enormous amount of work, and I've rarely come across such a beautifully organized and well thought through program as this one. So, je suis reconnaissant, very grateful and mindful that so much has been done here, and I thank you all. I'm pleased to be here at this conference devoted to thinking about philosophy and performance. I would like today to work within two different frameworks to conceptualize the relationship between social embodiment and the speech act. In recent years, we have seen the growth of performance studies throughout the world, and this has compelled many of us to rethink what we mean by performance and where we find it. On the one hand, it seemed important to distinguish performance studies from theater studies precisely in order to foreground performance as a kind of action or practice that does not require the proscenium stage. Performance can and does happen in the street or in the mall, in ordinary life, and even, we might say, in every possible instance of motion and stillness. On the other hand, it has been important to distinguish performance studies from theater in order to expand our conception of what the platform for bodily action can be. On the other hand, we make a mistake by failing to see the necessary overlaps between theater and performance, since the stage is hardly an unmovable plane, and there are ways of acting in the theater that move both actors and audiences on and off the stage. In other words, there are kinds of theater that allegorize the very distinction between theater and performance, and sometimes a found object on the street, a random plank, or even a toppled tank, can suddenly become a stage or a platform. And then certain kinds of conventions regarding movement and speech seem suddenly displaced from the proscenium stage onto the other surfaces of everyday life. Indeed, why not understand the proscenium as itself a roving or movable element? Perhaps when the proscenium does move or withdraw or turn up in spaces or on surfaces where it is not expected, we are already in the orbit of performance art and performance studies. I hope today to ask about the sense of performance we find in the performative speech act and performativity more generally, in order to understand where the body can be found in the relationship between language and performance. Along the way, I will be using the example of gender performativity, something I tend to do in Europe alone. Okay, anyway, I will be using the example of gender performativity to think about the somatic dimension of both the speech act and embodied performance. And then finally, I hope to consider the role of gesture as it crosses between language and performance, focusing on Walter Benjamin's discussion of epic theater in Brecht, which brings language and performance together in some unexpected ways, and where, I will suggest, the citational account of the speech act has consequences for how we think about forms of action that become suddenly shorn of context. The gesture, I will suggest, is an ethically consequential decomposition of the speech act, characteristic of epic theater that shares certain features with the performativity of gender. Part one, from Austin to embodiment. Of course, lingering in the background of any such proposal is the question, what is the difference between performance and performativity? Perhaps performativity is simply the quality of any given performance. We can talk about a performative dimension to an artwork and mean by that some way that the artwork performs, suggesting that it is active, that it intervenes upon and transforms a space, that it seems to exercise its own agency and effect. But are there other reasons to use that word, performativity? Even J.L. Austin, who developed the theory of performative speech act, spoke mainly about performatives as sentences and used performative as an adjective in order simply to bring out the generative or consequential dimensions of a particular speech act. The problem proved to be important for linguistics and philosophy, as we know, since it raises a set of fundamental questions. What acts when speech acts? What kind of action is a speech act? Under what conditions does speech act? On whom and where? Austin proposed, as you doubtless know, that though there has to be a speaker who utters the speech act, that speech acts not because of the subject's will, but because it relies upon certain social conventions that give a certain efficacy to the act. His examples tended to be judges as they condemn people to prison, or couples as they take vows of marriage. I don't know if there's a parallel there. We were meant to understand that the... I know we're supposed to be pro-marriage right now, right? So, and we were meant to understand that the juridical authority of the judge had been conventionally established, that the legal system in which the judge acts is working and considered legitimate. Sometimes the illocutionary utterance relies on the purported speech of God or divine authority or one of his delegated authorities. So Adam, for instance, can wander around in that garden and start to name what he sees, and those seen and named objects then become associated with that name. Some rather strong versions of authority back up the illocutionary speech act, the one that brings into being what it names, or radically transforms a situation into another through the utterance of the speech act. We can understand this as the socially generative or creative dimension of the speech act, one that is distinct from a second sort, which works by producing a set of consequences. That second sort, the perlocutionary speech act, is an utterance that does not create what it names, but it does set off some consequential effects. So yelling fire in a movie theater does not produce any fire. Indeed, it compels people to move with panic toward the exit. Sometimes calling a group of people assembled on the street a revolution does have the effect of bringing about what it names, in which case it is illocutionary, but other times it simply brings more people to the scene or dissuades some people from coming to the scene. Those latter are consequences of the speech act and establish it only as perlocutionary. But if the declaration under certain conditions, this is a revolution, actually produces the revolution, then that means that those who use the speech act have assumed the authority required to create the very phenomenon they name and to do it in the moment of naming, or it means that in the act of naming, they acquire the authority they require to make a revolution. So it has, for some time, been a question what this linguistic theory is doing in the midst of a theory of performance. After all, it's a theory that relies on utterances, only obliquely requires a subject, an embodied subject, and does not immediately seem to have a relation to any bodily action other than that of speaking. Indeed, we might say that it remains within a certain Roman conception of oratory that takes the speech act to be the consummate form of action. Does Austin's theory presume that everyone has the capacity to speak? Is it interested in the organic dimensions of vocalization, the throat, the diaphragm, or breathing, or tonality, or rhythm? Does the speaker have a somatic dimension, and does the speech act assume a sensuous expression? Can speech of this sort happen by machines or through sign language? Further, it's not that speakers make use of conventions to bring about certain realities or produce a certain set of consequences. Those conventions are already at work way before you or I speak them, and they only have the power that they do by virtue of their iterable status, the way they are repeated and elaborated in various institutional practices. So it may be said that those conventions and their iterability are what dispose any of us to act through speech. They act on our speech when we act, and they precede and exceed the moment of enunciation. It's important to take seriously the fact that a speech act does not simply act, but it is also acted on and derives whatever power it has to act from the citational chain in which it operates. Although we may well make certain declarations or utter certain imperatives wielding power through the speech act, those declarations and imperatives bring with them a history and a historicity that we did not make. There is an animating legacy of speech acts that act upon our speech and even act upon speech as it acts. If someone addresses me directly or speaks about me in the third person and they seek to summarize who I am with a name or a phrase, then that person is wagering that he or she will have or acquire sufficient authority and plausibility, and that the conventions that are required for illocutionary force will be marshaled to support the claim, and that others operate within the same language and with the same degree of knowingness. Their efforts to address me or to speak about me may fall flat, the way that declarations of revolution sometimes do. And if someone calls fire and there is no fire, or someone says that the stock market is about to fall, then consequences follow, but only if those speakers are within a certain field of audibility, within a space and time in which the utterance matters, and if those listening are directly affected by the event referenced by the speech act. I must have already been admitted into the language and the meaning of such exclamations before I can react to them as something other than imposing forms of noise. All of us are called names, and this kind of name-calling inaugurates an important dimension of the speech act, and I'm trying to move slowly towards the question of how this dimension of the speech act actually involves a somatic dimension. After all, it's not the case that we only act through the speech act. The speech act also acts upon us. There's a distinct performative effect of having been named as this gender or another gender, as part of one nationality or a minority, or to find out that how you are regarded in any of these respects is summed up by a name that you yourself perhaps did not know. We can and do ask, am I that name? How do we think about the force and effect of those names we are called before emerging into language as speaking beings, prior to any capacity for a speech act of our own? Does speech act upon us prior to our speaking? And if it did not act upon us, could we speak at all? And perhaps it's not simply a matter of sequence. Let's put the question this way. Does speech continue to act upon us at the very moment in which we speak, so that we may well think we are acting, but we are also acted upon at that very same time? Derrida clearly raised this question about Austin's theory, noting that what we call an act is a citational form, the repetition of what has come before, and a break with that prior history. Indeed, one of the major contributions of his signature event context is that we cannot understand the social conventions that make a speech act possible without understanding it as the yield and the enactment of a citational chain. So there is a historicity to the speech act, one that is citational, depends on iterability, and that means that although the speech act may seem punctual, it is uttered here, it is uttered now, within this space and time, it's only operative by virtue of referencing contexts that have vanished. In fact, the prior contexts of usage are invoked and vacated at the moment of the utterance, such that the speech act draws upon and breaks with the prior instances of its iteration. So if a certain version of social institutions is at work in the theory, one that calls upon established forms of power and authority, and if certain versions of embodiment and agency are implicit in the idea of the spoken act, then it seems that the Austinian theory of the speech act implicitly or explicitly calls upon an account of social embodiment and its relation to power. It calls upon it, even though the theory itself cannot directly address it. I would need more time to back up that claim, but it's rather clearly suggested by noting how the speech act cannot quite get away from the notion of performance. In addition to asking whether and in what sense the speech act is said to perform, we can also ask what performs when the speech act performs. In other words, what acts on speech when speech acts. Part two, gender performativity. Several years ago, Eve Sedgwick and I spent some time thinking about the relationship between performance and performativity. Sedgwick found that speech acts deviated from their aims, very often producing consequences that were altogether unintended and oftentimes quite felicitous. For instance, one could take a marriage vow, and this act could actually open up a zone of possible sexuality that takes place quite separately from marriage, understood as the publicly known and accepted institution that is said to organize sexuality in conjugal forms. She underscored the sense of how a speech act could veer away from its apparent aims, and this deviation was one sense of the word queer, understood less as an identity than as a movement of thought and language contrary to accepted forms of authority, opening up spaces for desire that would not always be openly recognized. I was perhaps initially interested in the metaleptic structure of gender inspired by Derrida's reading of Kafka's story, Before the Law. In that essay, Derrida considered the expectation that the law would one day reveal its inner secrets. He suggested that the expectation itself established the reality of the inner secret and so operated as a performative. We may think that the enigmatic essence of law produces the expectation that law will reveal itself in time, but Derrida's argument was that it is the expectation that posits the enigmatic essence, a kind of anticipatory performative. That reversal proved important to me as I thought about how several discourses on gender seem to create and circulate certain ideals of gender, generating those ideals, but taking them to be natural essences or internal truths that were subsequently expressed in those ideals. So the effect of a discourse, in this case, a set of gender ideals, was broadly misconstrued as the internal cause of one's desire and behavior, a core reality of femininity or masculinity that was then subsequently expressed in gestures and actions. That ostensible internal cause or core reality not only substituted for the social norm, but effectively masked and facilitated the operation of the norm. The formulation that gender is performative became the basis for many long discussions on topics, including two quite contrary interpretations. The first is that we radically choose our gender. The second was that we're utterly determined by gender norms. Those wildly divergent responses meant that something had not quite been articulated and grasped about the dual dimensions of any account of performativity. For if language acts upon us before we act, and in every instant in which we act, then we have to think about gender performativity first as gender assignment, all those ways in which we are, as it were, called a name and gendered prior to understanding anything about how gender norms act upon us and shape us and produce a number of ongoing quandaries for us. Indeed, sometimes I'm tempted to think that gender assignment can be understood as a primary and traumatic mode of name calling. And then secondly, following Sedgwick, we have to understand how deviations from those norms can and do take place, suggesting that something queer is at work at the heart of gender performativity, a queerness that is not so very different from the swerves taken by iterability in Derrida's account of the Speech Act as citational. So let us assume then that performativity describes both the processes of being acted on and the conditions and possibilities for acting, and that we cannot understand its operation without both of these dimensions. That norms act upon us implies that we are susceptible to their action, vulnerable to a certain name-calling from the start. And this registers at a level that is prior to any possibility of volition. An understanding of gender assignment has to take up this field of unwilled receptivity, susceptibility, and vulnerability, a way of being exposed to language prior to any possibility of forming or enacting a speech act. Norms such as these both require and institute certain forms of corporeal vulnerability without which their operation would not be thinkable. That is why we can and do describe the powerful citational force of gender norms as they are instituted and applied by medical, legal, and psychiatric institutions. And that's why we object to the effect they have on the formation and understanding of gender in pathological or criminal terms. And yet this very susceptibility, this condition of being affected, is also where something queer can happen, where the norm is refused or revised, or where new formulations of gender begin. Although gender norms precede us and act upon us, that is one sense of enactment, we are obligated to reproduce them, and that is a second sense of enactment. Precisely because something inadvertent and unexpected can happen in this realm of being affected, we find forms of gender that break with mechanical patterns of repetition, deviating from, resignifying, and sometimes quite emphatically breaking those citational chains of gender normativity, making room for new forms of gendered life. The theory of gender performativity, as I understood it, never prescribed which gender performances were right or more subversive, which were wrong and reactionary. The point, rather, was to relax the coercive hold of norms on gendered life, which is not the same as transcending all norms for the purposes of living a more livable life. So then, if performativity was considered as linguistic by Austin and by Derrida, how do bodily acts come to be regarded as performative? I want to suggest that both gesture and the citational act traverse the domain of language and performance, and that this dual sense of the performative is not only important for understanding the dynamic of gender performativity, but for understanding how gesture, conceived as both citation and event, might be understood as a critical practice. Am I moving too quickly? Are you with me? Okay. All right. Butler's, am I intelligible? Oh, don't answer. Oh. You disappoint me. No. She just wants to be unintelligible. Okay, that's back. Sorry, little citational event. Okay, having been called a name. Okay, yeah. All right, so my brief discussion of Austin only makes sense in relation to my brief discussion of gender performativity if we can identify the conventions that operate at the basis of the Speech Act with the norms that operate in a broad array of gender assigning strategies. Both of these discussions are only possible if we can see how the Speech Act affects and animates us in an embodied way. Indeed, the field of susceptibility and affect is already a matter of a corporeal registration of some kind. Indeed, the embodiment implied by both gender and performance is one that is dependent on institutional structures and broader social worlds. We cannot talk about a body without knowing what supports that body. and what its relationship is to that support, or indeed to that lack of support. In this way, the body is less an entity than a relation, and it cannot be fully dissociated from the infrastructural and environmental conditions of its living. Part three, gesture as unsupported action. There's so much to be said about this, but I want at this juncture to call attention to Shannon Jackson's recent work, Social Work, her book, Social Work, that argues that performance art has to be understood as requiring a coordinated set of social relations and networks of support, and that it gives us a chance to reflect upon the social organizations of life that secure the welfare and livability of lives. For Jackson, performance is invariably social and infrastructural. Even the monologue requires a platform and a structured space that some group of people have found and built and arranged. Moreover, there is no performance without the broader coordination of the event. For Jackson, performance emerges from shared social worlds, so no matter how individual and fleeting any given performance may be, it relies upon and reproduces an enduring, or at least a durational, set of social relations, community practices, infrastructures, labor and institutions, all of which turn out to be part of the very performance itself. In a way, Social Work, the name of her book, names as well two dimensions of performance. There is a working together that constitutes the social condition and stuff of performance, and there is a chance to recreate community through the kinds of performances undertaken. And all of these compel us to think anew about some rather fundamental theoretical questions. First, are the human and the object worlds that together make a performance possible also what make up the performance? Are such worlds carried and conveyed, made or unmade, in the performances that we do and are, the ones we see and hear, the ones that lay claim to our responsiveness and by acting on us, tacitly restructure how we sense the world and come to act as we do? Gender performance shares some feature with what we might more generally call performance, an action that involves a number of people, objects, and institutions, even when it is without a stage, taking place in the briefest of moments, punctual and evanescent. For it's for and with someone or some set of things, always relying on a ground or a background, a platform, or a social world, even perhaps a momentarily passing crowd, in order to come forth as performance at all. And yet, as much as we might contemplate the general social and embodied conditions of performance, we cannot from this perspective alone account for the shifting historical specificities of its form, the vexing way that historical time enters into the time of performance and becomes refracted there. Both performance and disability studies have offered the crucial insight that all action requires support, and that even the most punctual and seemingly spontaneous act implicitly depends upon an infrastructural condition that quite literally supports the acting body. This idea of support is quite important not only for the retheorization of the acting body, but for the broader politics of the arts for which institutional support is necessary, and also for the politics of mobility, what architectural supports have to be in place for each of us to exercise a certain freedom of movement. And for the politics of public assembly, are there spaces and forms of social and material support for collective action or acting in concert, as Hannah Arendt would say. In the same way that we claim that the speech act depends upon its social conditions and conventions, we can also say that performance, more generally, depends upon its infrastructural and social conditions of support, and that this bears implications for a general account of embodied and social action. I cannot give that account today, though I am working on it. But I want to pause right here to ask some further questions about the infrastructural conditions and conventions that allow for both creative and consequential action. For instance, when traditional supports fall away, what form does action take? When the absence of infrastructural support becomes the very reason for action, and when we act precisely because there are inadequate forms of institutional support for the lives we are trying to live, how do we understand such action? Perhaps it is supported by forms of solidarity that emerge among people who have lost their ground or that feel that their lives are being lived without the kinds of traditional supports that lives require. On the one hand, if we maintain that infrastructure is necessary for human action, we help to debunk the idea that we each individually act from our own strength or with our own power, that we are self-sufficient and self-motoring, and that social conventions and social institutions more generally do not provide necessary support for our actions. We can, through this perspective, de-ratify forms of individualistic autonomy that consistently efface the social conditions required for efficacious action and livability. On the other hand, if we assume that such infrastructural conditions are necessary for action, that none of us act without infrastructural conditions that support us, we could inadvertently commit ourselves to the proposition that only those who are already supported can truly act. In that case, we fail to grasp how those who are deprived of adequate infrastructure can and do mobilize resistance to the conditions of accelerating precarity and inequality, right? So we need to be able to take account of that second dimension. These latter forms of mobilization are what we have witnessed in the last few years as crowds gather to object to increasing social and economic inequality, to increased precarity and unpayable debt, to the rise of securitarian and authoritarian modes of power, and to the new and old forms of fascism that are finding their way into state and regional governments in your neighborhoods. To understand that task, I want to take another turn, which is to consider the relationship between citation and gesture in Benjamin's account of Brecht's epic theater. It may seem like something of a stretch, but let us remember that Derrida's own critique of Austin relies on an idea of citationality that I would suggest first emerges in Benjamin's reading of Brecht and Kafka as he works out his theory of gesture. Okay, controversial. Avital will tell me if I'm wrong. Indeed, the key criticism that Derrida makes against Austin, namely, that a citation breaks with the context from which it originates, is already found in an incipient form in Benjamin's description of epic theater. Quotation, Benjamin writes, is precisely the interruption of a context. That distance from the original context is a precondition of quotability or citationality. There could be no citation without that distance, without that irreversible break. For Benjamin, this leads to the conclusion that epic theater, which relies on the narrating of deeds with explicit commentary, is quotable, is marked and defined by its quotability. It is constantly breaking from the context of the play to speak didactically, but also lifting utterances from their functional purposes and displaying them in quotable form. The where and when of a quotation is always to some extent lost in the moment of its emergence and display. The citation marks the moment in which the everyday context is suspended or lost, and so the quotation becomes a gesture, that is, a truncated form of action that has lost the context of its established intelligibility. Benjamin's own brief essays on Kafka refer to the problem of Kafka's incomplete gestures. The gesture was understood as a kind of stalled action, one that could not quite become action, that was something less than a fully formed act. Benjamin remarked that Kafka's literary work divests the human gesture of its traditional supports and then has a subject for reflection without end. Okay, so that's a quotation. Kafka's literary work, according to Benjamin, divests the human gesture of its traditional supports and then has a subject for reflection without end. I'm not sure whether Kafka's work actively divests the human gesture of its traditional supports or whether it finds that gestures have lost those supports. And I am not sure that that infinite reflection is a hopeful consequence. After all, that may well be a bad infinity opened up by gestures such as these. But one reason to say that the work divests the human gesture of traditional supports is that Kafka then seems to be writing in much the same way that Brecht wanted to direct. After all, the gesture is tactically separated from completed action in Brecht's dramaturgical writings. It is meant to be wrenched from the temporal flow of ordinary action and to be presented in relative isolation from what follows. Similarly, the gesture is no longer propped up by a taken-for-granted world and so seems to have been deprived of its usual grounding in both temporal sequence and infrastructural support. For Brecht, this isolation and freezing of the gesture is meant to denaturalize the ways that bodily gestures follow from one another, forming perceptual and practical unities. One can see rather clearly how a Brechtian method of this kind might lead to a denaturalization of gender, bringing into relief bodily movements like gait, the stride, gesticulations with the hands, expressions, smiles are big gender-wise, turns, bends, stretches, how and whether one leans, holds the mouth or the chin or the lips. Such moments occur in Kafka's literary work when, for instance, a leg no longer functions but has to be lifted and placed on a surface, or two hands clapping are described as an industrial set of hammers. Usually, there are body parts that have lost their aim, or speech and action are working in opposing ways so that a facial expression has nothing to do with what is said, something that happens all the time in the trial. In the castle, there's a scene between Frida and the surveyor where all the affect seems out of joint. She explains that she's the mistress of a certain clam. At that point, she, and I quote, involuntarily straightened up a little, and her triumphant glance, which has no connection whatever with what she was saying, end quote. This same kind of disjunction between body and speech happens much earlier in description of a struggle where the body lacks coordination as well. The narrator, for instance, seeks a confrontation with another person and writes, "I screwed up my mouth, this being the best preparation for resolute speech, and supported myself by standing on my right leg while resting the left one on its toes, for this position, as I have often experienced it, gives me a sense of stability," end quote. Adorno, responding to Benjamin, suggests here that gesture crystallizes the way that what the body does and what is said are disjoint, a certain unmasterable arbitrariness characterizes the relation between what the body does and what the person says. In other words, it would seem that the gesture allegorizes the decomposition of the speech act. If we expect a body to perform its words in continuity or in conformity with the oratorical standard of the speech act, the gesture marks the impossibility of that particular coordination. Indeed, the problem is not that such coordination happens not to be possible now, but that that possibility is now historically lost. Gestures such as these approximate what happens on the Brechtian stage, at least in theory. The motion and integrity of the body seems to be at issue in both. Benjamin's What is Epic Theater opens with a figure of a body relaxed and reading, only then to interrupt that repose by suddenly positing that theater is the opposite. Sitting, or indeed standing in the theater, the one who follows what happens on the theatrical stage is described as rapt. He is said to follow the action with every fiber of his being. So already within the first paragraph of that essay, we're introduced to a body quite gripped by the performance it watches. The performance is followed as a visualized and dramatized sequence at a distance from the body that is watching. But if every fiber is involved in that watching, then the body is also seized by what it sees. For Benjamin, Brecht offers something different. The notion of one who follows the action, not as an individual, but as a collective, one for whom the reaction is not the same as the individual body gripped in the face of a fascinating spectacle, bound up with what it watches. If anything, the collective who watches, or the one who watches, as it were, from the perspective of the collective, is ungripped by what it sees, considers the action from a position of attentive consideration and especially of interest. Those who follow have an interest in what they follow, and what they follow appears in two different but simultaneous ways. When they are seized by what they see, the object is a form of action with which one identifies. But the second way of seeing, distanciated but interested, attentive but critical, is what Brecht calls performance. And so a distinction is introduced in this rather breathless first paragraph between action and performance. The distinction permits Benjamin to describe, on the one hand, an action that can be followed on the basis of one's experience, and where we're not really differentiated from what we see, where we are identified and sympathetic, and where the sympathy fails to differentiate the one who watches from the action watched. Performance, on the other hand, is something mounted by someone else, where one's own way of seeing is interrupted by another's way of seeing. It implies a director whose deliberate forms of orchestration are considered pellucid. As we consider this deliberate orchestration, we are constituted as a we who are implicated together in what we see, and this very plurality, we become, it would appear, we become capable of attentive and critical thinking. So that once wrapped body that is associated with spectacle and sensation is put out of play. Indeed, to the extent that epic theater takes historical events as its subjects, its point is, and I quote again, intended to purge them of the sensational. For Benjamin, the event will be related to the gesture, that incomplete or fragmented form of action that has been deprived of its traditional supports. Indeed, in his writing on Kafka, Benjamin tells us that the gesture has become the event. What constitutes, then, the truly epic process in Benjamin's terms must have to do with a desensationalized and thoughtful relation to the course of historical events, one that Benjamin will call critical. It must center on events rather than on outcomes, and in this way is distinguished from tragic drama, which it seems relies on suspense and so recasts the importance of events as actions and finds their meaning in the ultimate human destiny to which they lead. So in focusing on action, the audience not only recognizes that it is itself constituted as a collective, but that its own dispassionate and critical attention to the action on stage is part of what constitutes that action as such. At one point, I would say actually constitutes that action as performance. At one point, Benjamin writes, this collective thinker is not dissociable from the action, but constitutes, in fact, the hero of the drama. If this is true, then the action takes place not merely on stage, and certainly not over there, on the far side of an epistemological divide between seer and seen. The thinker in this scene is off the stage, but part of the scene, and he or she is an individual, but also a collective, though it remains difficult to distinguish the two. Whatever thinking happens traverses the distinction between individual and collective, though it may not utterly override that distinction. What happens when this form of thinking is deliberately orchestrated, as it is in the case of performance, which implies directorial agency? Thinking that is called thinking is under contemporary social and economic conditions, displaced from its usual context and from a naturalized understanding of everyday life. Indeed, the thinker, the individual and plural subject, is jolted from the natural attitude through a series of interruptions. Indeed, interruption is what leads to astonishment, erstaunung, in the face of the circumstances under which everyone lives and works. These circumstances are historical conditions of work that are exposed and delineated precisely through the presentation of events that are frozen or decontextualized in certain ways, removed from what passes as the natural and the ordinary flow of existence. In effect, the deliberate task of the director is to educate the audience to be astonished. Of course, I have some objections to this, but I'm just going to let them go for a moment. Disposed toward a critical astonishment that is no natural or immediate inclination. This is an astonishment about the historical conditions under which they live and work. This is a specific performance of epic theater and what distinguishes it from, say, Aristotelian action. To undergo this astonishment and to see or behold these conditions of life, one cannot start with identification or empathy or rapt attention. On the contrary, one starts with verfremdung. One is startled by verfremdung, a sense of alienation from those conditions that become astonishingly there to see as if for the first time. They become graspable only through a dehistoricization, a break or rupture of such a kind that these conditions can no longer be contextualized. They break out of the continuity of history, we might say, and the naturalized understanding of social relations. Perhaps we can now see how Benjamin's version of Brecht enters through a side door into Derrida's signature event and context. And perhaps as well the resonance with the theory of gender performativity is on display insofar as that theory sought to transpose and animate the somatic dimension of the speech act for a bodily enactment of the performative. That enactment was understood as a variably subversive citational strategy that sought to arrest and disorient the so-called natural course of gender performance, and so perhaps approximated a Brechtian project of denaturalization. Here, Ellen Diamond's extraordinary work on Brecht and feminism is crucial. When Benjamin describes interruption in Brecht's epic theater, he gives us an example of gender, class, and violence. He describes what he calls a primitive scene in which, and I quote here, suddenly a stranger enters. The mother is just about to seize a bronze bust and hurl it at her daughter. The father was in the act of opening the window in order to call a policeman. Einem Schutzmann zu rufen. Okay, so he simply introduces this scene into his text. The scene emerges suddenly for the stranger, but also for the reader. We have no context for what is happening. It is fair to say that it's an astonishing scene of violence. It matters that it's a domestic scene, since the violence that astonishes us emerges within and from the traditional family and bourgeois life, and the father, unable to intervene, gets ready to call upon the greater paternal authority of the police to invade the familial territory and stop a potential murder, the murder that the mother is about to commit in relation to the daughter. Indeed, this seems to be violence directed from the mother against the daughter at the heart of the bourgeoisie, one that depends upon police intervention. Why is it a statue, a bronze one, that's about to be thrown? Seems like it is an imitation of some kind, not gold, so not the most original and superior form of the head. The German eine Bronze is translated as a bust. What does it mean to take the replica of a head as a murderous instrument to be directed at the daughter? Someone or something has already lost its head, or the head has become severed from the body, and it's now a lethal instrument, except the head is no longer a head but a copy, and so already having suffered a severing of its own and functioning as a replica, is clearly deprived of its original body and original scene, and now traveling in murderous worlds where it does not belong. This bronze bust does not act on its own, but if the mother has lost her mind and is now about to throw a head, then some sort of decomposition, displacement, and simulation of the human body has already occurred and set the scene, some alienation of the body or fetishism of the object or relic of ruined work weaponized. And now it seems that the family, this family, but any family, since there's no context for this family, excuse me, will also be destroyed or invaded by this, what, inanimate citation of a head that once belonged to a citational body, or should have but never did. Its citational character marks the distance between that bust and any possible person it might be replicating. Was it royalty? Was it authority? So something's already lost, and something irrecoverable in this scene in which the mother appears to be about to injure or destroy the daughter and the family, precipitating the entry of the police and then, by implication, the courts and the prison. Did the head start this business, or was it rather some prior loss of bearing and orientation that established this scene without context, the one that Benjamin suddenly starts to write in the middle of his paragraph, a kind of directorial performative, right? We can't not read it, but we don't really know how to read it. It's maybe a Brechtian performative that establishes this nearly murderous moment with a sudden start and stop and does not and cannot tell us what happens next. We can see this as a form of alienation to be sure, and that interpretation would follow the directorial imperative of a Brechtian kind. The human body has come apart and its head has become a commodity that appears on the shelf of the family dining room as if a beheading has already taken place. Perhaps this is the murderous trace of a certain form of alienated labor, or one of the last remaining relics of the aristocracy that is about to take on new meaning as a lethal weapon. For Benjamin, who obviously took Marx seriously for many years, this is surely a possible reading. But I want to suggest that there's also another reading, one in which Benjamin is suggesting that the violent act against the institution of the family and bourgeois life, even the criminal act of murder, is itself a critical practice. Is this an operation, we might say, of divine violence, that difficult notion that provides such an unsettling and sudden end to his essay, A Critique of Violence? Concerning Macheath, the criminal in Threepenny Opera, Benjamin notes that there is a minority who find him to be admirable, even a social model and a born leader. He does not defend those laws that protect property relations, and his criminality is figured as a way of exposing the injustice of the law. Do we read Benjamin's description of Macheath's noble stature as ironic? Is this Benjamin's view, or is this just a view he's reporting on? In the Critique of Violence, Benjamin argues that legal regimes inflict their own violence, and that one has to take a point of view outside of law and its justificatory procedures to understand the violence of law itself. Divine violence is associated with that critical practice that suspends the hold of legal regimes on their subjects. In Benjamin's narrative entitled Conversations with Brecht, he narrates that Brecht stands in front of Benjamin, imitating the state and saying, and I quote, with a sidelong squint at imaginary clients, I know I ought to be abolished, end quote. This narrated performance is hardly an ideological defense of the violent dismantling of the state, or even an argument for the full disregard of the rule of law. Benjamin does credit Brecht with, and here I quote, removing the drapings of legal concepts. At the end of A Critique of Violence, Benjamin wonders whether an attack on law is now imaginable and mentions in this regard, and I quote, the divine judgment of the multitude on a criminal. This remark has made some wonder whether Benjamin is moving toward mass violence, whether he's approving of it. Divine violence is associated with messianic power, and those all may be reasons why Brecht notoriously accuses Benjamin of siding with so-called Jewish fascism, although that remark is actually about the literary perspective of Kafka with which it seems Benjamin has affiliated. And yet in those examples, these examples of potential violence, and in the scene that Benjamin effectively directs in his essay on Brecht, something else seems to be going on, since no completed picture of a destructive action is ever offered in either text, neither in the essay on Amphitheater nor in the Critique of Violence. We search in vain for examples that illustrate what Benjamin means by divine violence, only to realize that the example cannot help us here. After all, Benjamin stops the scene quite suddenly, giving us only the gesture, the frozen image, but not the act of violence. There's no textual basis on which to conclude that the act of violence will or did take place, since, after all, we are reading a fiction. And if it does, and it does stop where it stops. If interruption clearly characterizes the starting and stopping of the familial scene of violence, then we might well conclude that the gesture has in fact replaced the action and indefinitely postponed the violence. Indeed, if one asks at the end of A Critique of Violence whether Benjamin imagined a full destruction of society or its laws, one is running out way ahead of the text without noting that the essay stops precisely at that question, thwarting the answer to that question, refusing any definitive example. That is, we might say, Benjamin's directorial act, but it also may be a felicitous effect that the gesture has to take us into and out of ordinary scenes of violence without quite allowing for their commission. In other words, the gesture stops violence at the moment when it seems ready to become action. The gesture, then, we might understand as the partial decomposition of the performative that arrests action before it can prove lethal. Perhaps this kind of stalling, cutting, and stopping establishes an intervention into violence, an unexpected nonviolence through an indefinite stall, one affected by interruption and citation alike. In other words, the multiplication of gestures makes the violent act citable, brings it into relief as the structure of what people sometimes do or almost do, but it does not quite do it. Indeed, it relinquishes the satisfaction of the complete act for what may prove to be an ethos of restraint. I know that Freddie Rokem will draw our attention to this passage and to some others, so I will bring my own remarks to a close. I want only to add that there's a horizon within which the threat of violent destruction suddenly emerges in the story that Benjamin tells us, the scene he directs. The institution of the family has already come apart in some rather consequential ways, such that the mother, which mother, might threaten to hurt or kill the daughter, which daughter, with some replica, some ruin, some dismembered and displaced copy of a head that is far removed from any original context. The mother, after all, does not throw that bronze statue, at least not in the scene that we're given. She's only poised to throw it. So what we have received, as it were, in the reading of Benjamin is still a frozen image, and so precisely a gesture that does not convert to action, but might may be understood to be its own event. Benjamin stopped that throw, we might say, through directorial fiat, working like an interdiction against violence before any police power has the chance to arrive. And so the scene stands as an interdicted action, a truncated narrative, drawing on theatrical, literary, and cinematic traditions, so precisely not an act, but a gesture, the gesture as a citation of an action that becomes its own event. Perhaps at such a moment we can see why Benjamin counters Brecht's charge of Jewish fascism, a term we can talk about in a minute, with the suggestion that in Kafka, the true measure of life is remembrance. This is all the more urgent when life appears precisely as a set of fleeting moments, swiftly receding horizons, unfulfilled acts. Remembrance, Benjamin tells us, traverses life with the speed of lightning and is always thwarted by the brevity of life, the loss of one perspective by the establishment of another. This Benjaminian practice might be considered a counter to Brechtian astonishment, suggesting that the decomposition of the speech act into gesture is not only the sign of critical capacity, but of grief for what decomposes us as we compose, and for what is no longer possible, for the loss of those traditional supports and tradition itself that cannot be restored. After all, that mother was about to throw a hard piece of some tradition at her daughter, and we do not know which one. We can neither recover that history nor conceptualize the act when gesture becomes the event. In the best of circumstances, such disconcerting moments of citation, those incomplete performances, can bring to a halt what has become both very usual and utterly wrong. Thank you.